I can remember on Saturday mornings, I was probably 10 or 11 years old, I got to work with Dad, because we worked, of course, on a 5.5-day week. And I'd go down Saturday mornings with him, and I got to load cans onto a belt from the back end of the truck. The Kansas City branch of the Folger Coffee Company was a family affair. My grandfather first, then Dad, when he passed on, Dad took over as head of the company then. My Uncle Joe and my Uncle Frank were all in the business. Dad had retired. He didn't feel there was anybody really ready to take over that big a management jump. We got Procter & Gamble stock in exchange for Folger stock, and they took the control. So we merged into their operation. Sounds better than a sale. I don't drink Folgers anymore, although I'm sure the gourmet would be fine. To get fresh coffee that I like, I'm roasting my own coffee, buying green coffee that I know from experience is good, and roasting my own, grinding it, and roasting it every other day, so I always have fresh coffee. Good to have fresh coffee to wake up with.
Yes.
Boston bean, soy bean, how have you been, string bean? I'm not keen for a bean, unless it is the cheery coffee bean. I love coffee, I love tea, I love the jab, the jive, and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the jive and me.
During World War II, because it was very difficult to brew coffee while you were in a trench, instant coffee became quite popular.
We wanted to get something to the troops in the trenches in Europe, where it was cold and it was dank and it was horrible living conditions, that would both keep them alert and help them keep warm.
The military depends upon it, because military actions have to go on around the clock. And lives depend on them, people being alert and sharp. The best agent they found to produce alertness and improve performance is caffeine.
Tea's all right in its place, I guess. But in the Navy, you will learn to make and enjoy a good cup of coffee. We call it Joe. It'll be your friend throughout many a cold watch, and it's also a way to say welcome aboard to your shipmate.
During World War II, the United States was willing to take part in some kind of coffee control scheme because they were afraid that Latin America was going to go Nazi.
In 1940, Brazilians found that the collapse of the European coffee markets had almost wrecked an industry which had been in distress since 1930. U.S. diplomats realized with alarm that if Brazil's economy were allowed to break down, the friendly government of Getulio Vargas might not long survive. To meet the crisis, the U.S. government underwrote the entire unshipped balance of Brazil's coffee crop for 1941, 42, and 43. Time marches on.
After the war, the coffee corporations bring instant coffee out of the trenches and into the kitchens.
The amazing coffee discovery. You know,
any resemblance to real coffee is purely coincidental. But instant refined crystals made from cheap brewed coffee go well with the post-war rage for everything modern.
The instant coffee that they were making, that Maxwell House and Nestle was making, it was such bad quality that it didn't matter whether you used good beans or not. They would be ruined in the process, so why pay money for good beans?
Maxwell House coffee sale. Save money and enjoy the coffee.
The big roasters got into these price wars with each other. And they would cheapen the blend to all the cheapest possible canned coffee in the store. They would put more and more of the Robusta beans, the cheaper beans, into the blend. And as a result, what was happening was people were drinking less and less coffee. They were literally drinking less cups, but in the cups, they were making more and more dilute coffee because it tasted so bad.
While Americans are drinking worse and worse blends, Canadians are dunking their donuts in a finer brew. Hockey great Tim Hortons stick handles his way from pucks to donuts, and good coffee to wash them down.
The early marriage of the coffee and donut was an important one. Canadians love donuts. We're the biggest donut-consuming nation per capita in the world. Two loves of Canadians, good coffee and a good donut at the same time under one roof. Tim Hortons is a quintessential Canadian coffee story, and the Canadian response has been pretty dramatic.
In Quebec, a new French immigrant is missing the fine coffee back home. Pawning his wife's diamond earrings, Albert-Louis Van Hoot buys a Jabez Burns roaster and begins roasting beans in the back of his gourmet store.
Well, I was very young, but still I could remember. I was going to the store on Ontario Street there, and I remember that it was smelling different, you see, from the street. When you get in the store, it was really a good perfume of coffee. My father wanted to have very good coffee, the bon mélange. It's an art to make a good coffee. If you think you can put coffee in the roaster and no, you have to follow the processes of doing a good coffee. Otherwise, you cannot make a good coffee.
What Americans are buying isn't good coffee, but a mass-marketed commodity, a hot brown liquid to recharge the batteries. Rather than improving quality, the big roasters try to sell more through advertising.
It's ironic that one of the most famous and one of the most really lilting and wonderful television ads for coffee is the Maxwell House percolator theme, and it's celebrating a pretty bad way to make coffee, because the percolators, especially in the 50s when this ad came out, would, you know, recirculate the coffee and get it more and more bitter. But, you know, everybody knows this theme. I think it goes bum 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 bum. And, you know, it's a very happy little ting.
Pour a cup of this good-smelling coffee. It will taste as good as it's...
Folgers is the proud owner of the best and longest-lasting advertising campaign in the United States.
Honey, your coffee's miserable.
Honey, you won't be able to give your coffee away.
Ned, really? I just can't make good coffee.
Mrs. Olson would help solve that problem by helping explain how Mountain Grown Folgers would be a much better product and help satisfy everybody drinking it.
Ever try Folgers?
Folgers coffee?
Yeah.
Is there some trick to it?
Folgers is mountain grown.
Mountain grown?
That's the richest kind.
When Mrs. Olson first came out, we all kind of laughed because she always wore an apron, and none of us wore aprons, even though that was kind of the housewifely thing to do.
Right. Hey, what happened to your coffee, sweetheart?
Sweetheart, this coffee's great.
Now that's what I call coffee.
Coffee is only getting better in TV land. While on the streets, consumers continue to drink less. Corporate roasters now attempt to get them to drink more by introducing new products, like Sanka, coffee sans caffeine. Without caffeine, consumers can drink as much bad coffee as they please.
Okay, Cookie, what are you peddling now? Hey, a broken duck. Yeah, well, get him out of here.
Thanks, sir. Could I have some coffee?
You have to know yourself when you're using any drug, any substance.
This is my last warning, Sergeant. Tell your men to stop harassing my client.
You take too much, you're going to feel funny.
So you relax with that pot of ground Sanka coffee.
Where'd you find him?
At the zoo, swimming with the seals.
You got anything to say for yourself?
Okay.
It gets you through the day.
For many, it's still regular coffee that gets them through the night. in their local 24-hour diner, over their bottomless 10-cent cup.
I'm feeling mighty lonesome, haven't slept a wink.
But in the mid-50s, the days of the 10-cent cup are numbered.
In between I drink black coffee.
When Brazil is hit by bad weather, a scarcity of coffee pushes the market price up for the first time in decades.
Everybody's always looking at the weather in Brazil to see, is there going to be a drought or is there going to be a freeze? Those are the two things everybody elsewhere in the world prays for, and some people in Brazil pray for, because it boosts the price of coffee. So in 1950 and in 1954, that happened. The price spiked very quickly.
Monday, August 27th, 1956, coffee increased another 3 cents a pound wholesale. I don't know how much it went up retail, but it probably went up. Among them were Chase and Tanburn, Manning's, Maxwell House, MJB, I mentioned then Folgers, were expected to follow suit. In most cases, the increase in the price of green coffee from South America is given the reason for the hike. Well, that's true. It had gone up.
I can't think that if the price of corn went up substantially that we would have congressional hearings. But that's because corn is grown in the United States. But when the price of coffee spikes, we have congressional hearings. This happened in 1950, 1954, 1977. At the 1950 hearings, a guy named Andres Uribe from Colombia testified before Congress, and it's a remarkable speech that he gave, and it's still true today, where he basically said, look, when you're talking about coffee, you're not just talking about a simple commodity. You're talking about the lives of millions of people.
Uribe continues his testimony. We in Latin America have a task before us which is staggering. Illiteracy to be eliminated, disease to be wiped out, a sound program of nutrition to be worked out for millions of people. If we could secure a fair price, we could work a miracle. If not, then you cast these millions to drift in a sea of poverty.
It's the coffee that goes with happy times. The richest coffee flavor known is Folgers flavor.
No one pays much attention to Uribe. Consumers know little about the problems of producers in the South, and the big roasters have no trouble ignoring the situation. Mountain grown. Caught up in Cold War paranoia, Americans dismiss the speech as one more example of communist subversion. Bus fares can go up without fanfare, but coffee is another matter. At the urging of the roasters, U.S. politicians let Latin America know that the way to make more money from their coffee is simply to sell more.
I would walk in the darkness before you came along.